You have conducted a DOE, visualized the results, used ANOVA to create a model that you can now use for decision making. But how good will the decisions be that you're going to make? Hey, my name is Marcel, I have a PhD in chemical engineering, and this is a video about model control, which in my eyes is a completely underrated concept. So let's get started. One of the simplest forms of model validation is visually comparing predicted values to measured values. A good fit captures the overall trend of the data, and it might be completely fine if the predicted values, which are illustrated by the red line here, slightly deviate from the measured values. For the bad fit, you see that the model does not match the overall trend of the data. Even though the overall deviation might be smaller, the measured data also shows a clear curvature that is not captured by the model. Now you see, this was a relatively easy example because we only had one factor to look at. But as the complexity of your system increases, the visual comparison alone won't do the job, and that's where residual analysis comes into play. So what exactly are residuals? Residuals are simply the difference between what you observed and what your model predicted. They're key in understanding just how accurate your model really is. If you're looking for one single number or value that you can use to compare different models or to get a feel for how good your model actually is, then you can use the RSS, or the residual sum of squares value. Basically, RSS adds up all the squared residuals. Why squared? Well, we don't want the positive and negative errors to cancel each other out, so squaring them ensures we account for all the deviations. The smaller the RSS, the better your model. But there's a catch. RSS isn't really standardized, so its value can change depending on the scale of your data and how many data points you have. That makes it hard to compare across different models or data sets. A much better way is the mean squared error. It is the RSS divided by the number of measuring points. That makes it independent from the number of data points, but scale will still influence it. This is where R squared comes in handy. You've probably seen R squared before if you've ever used Microsoft Excel. It's standardized and ranges between 0 and 1, making it much easier to interpret. Essentially, it tells you how much of the variation in your response can be explained by the model. An R squared of 1 means that your model is spot on and it explains 100% of the variance within your data. An R squared of 0, on the other hand, means that your model explains nothing. It's no better than just using the average of the observed data for predictions. And if you're somewhere in between 0 and 1, you're capturing a proportion of the variance. For example, if you've got an R squared of 0.9, your model explains 90% of the variation. But like everything in life, R squared is also not without its limitations, because it doesn't tell you if your model is missing something important, like a nonlinear relationship or maybe a time-dependent effect. And that's where residual plots come in. And basically, there are two important: residuals versus predicted and residuals versus run. A residuals versus predicted plot is a simple way to see if there's anything off with your model. On the y-axis, you've got the residuals, and on the x-axis, the predicted values. What you want is a nice random scatter of points. If you see a pattern like a trumpet shape, it's a sign that your model isn't capturing the data well enough. Maybe you need to transform your data, add an interaction term, or perhaps a quadratic term is missing. The residuals versus run plot looks at your residuals over the sequence in which your experiments were run. Again, a random scatter is what you're looking for, and if you notice any trends in this plot, it might mean that there's a time-related effect going on, like temperature shifts during the experiment. Blocking and randomization help ensure that these trends do not affect the analysis much and you still get valuable data that you can work with. If you want to learn more about blocking and randomization, make sure to check out the video that I linked in the video description. Otherwise, don't forget to like and subscribe, and see you in the next video.